So welcome everybody, how are we doing? So nice to be here. I can see, again, real people. Besides watching that small screen and talking and nobody is asking anything, or I can see that, did they get it? Okay, so without further ado, disclaimer, RSS disclaimer, and mine is that everything I'm talking to you here is are my opinions. So don't sue Secureworks, because what I'm saying here. And yeah, I'm from Finland. I work as a security researcher for Secureworks, counter threat unit, and I try to find vulnerabilities. And I think most of you know me, if you know me, about my AAD internals toolkit. How many have used that? I know at least one, okay. Yeah, I think some will try to use that after this session, I hope so. And some of you might know that Microsoft is publishing a list of Microsoft Security Response Center, or MSRC, is publishing a list of most valuable security researchers during the Black Hat, and I made this list last year. Woohoo! Well, I was last, but still on the list, and my colleague said from UK that, but at least you was the best Finn. Guess what? I didn't. We have Aapo. Yeah. Okay, so if anyone here are hurry and you need to leave or catch a flight, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you now. So during this session, I'm just going to tell you that to protect your cloud, you need to protect your on-prem environment. That's it. You can go. Okay. But this session, I will cover three things. The first is that which kind of authentication options you have in Azure AD, and then what kind of integrations, on-prem integrations, are involved with those options, and what kind of threats they are. And finally, how to mitigate them, and how to harden your environment that those wouldn't be exploited. And to make points, I'm going to show you some demos using my AAD Internals Toolkit, but also I'm going to do some interactive demos with you guys, so I need your help to participate in demos. I haven't tried that with this big audience earlier, but we'll see how it goes. Okay, so when I was preparing this presentation, I wanted to, you know, get more facts behind the things I'm saying here. So I did some OSINT, or open source intelligence research, about Fortune 500 organizations and 2,000 the most, well, top 2,000 universities globally. And I gathered information, and the statistics I'm showing to you are based on that research, and that's actually published in a real scientific conference, and you can get that paper if you want by clicking that link, which is in the PDFs you should have had already. And here's an example that there is a lot of information that's very easy to get. So as long as you know organization domain name, that's enough to get a lot of information. Here's an example. I think that those are quite small. Can you read that? Yeah, okay. So as long as you know organizations, like here's Intel domain name, you can get a lot of information. Like, is that that organization using a thing called desktop single sign-on? That's a technical name for seamless single sign-on. And you can list all the domains the organization have. Are they using email with those domains? And are they managed or federated? And if they are federated, you can see what's the identity provider name here. And all that is open source. Everybody can get that information. Okay, but then let's start. So Azure AD, any estimation how many of Fortune 500 organizations is using Azure AD? Anyone?
All of them?
Not, but almost. So 88%. And from top 2,000 universities, 95%. So it's safe to say that everybody is using Azure AD. Okay. So then we will go to identities. So there are two types of identities you can use with Azure AD. So first is cloud-only identity, or cloud identity, where users are only in cloud, like for small organizations, They just log into portal, give their username and password, and they are good to go. But then we also have hybrid identities for large organizations. So if you want to use same credentials when you log into your domain, your local domain, and use them also in cloud, you need to use hybrid identity. And today we are talking about hybrid identities, not the cloud identity. Because cloud identity is safe, hybrid isn't. Okay, so for hybrid authentication or identities, there are three options currently. And the first one is identity federation. Anyone heard of this earlier? Yeah, and this was the first solution that allowed users to use same credentials in on-prem and cloud. And this is based on trust between identity provider, which usually is your own identity provider, and usually it's implemented using ADFS, which is Microsoft's solution for federation. And the second one, and by the way, the identity federation allowed you also do the seamless single sign-on. So when you are logged into your domain to a computer, you can also automatically log into cloud. But that required a lot of hardware, for instance. So minimum was 2 ADFS servers and also 2 proxy servers, because you don't want to put servers that are domain joined to, you know, internet, so you need those proxies too. So at least 4 servers just to log in. And then came password hash synchronization, where you synchronize hashes from your on-prem AD to cloud. They are not the NT hashes. Well, actually they are, but they are rehashed using SHA-256 1,000 times, and you also have salt, so they can't be reversed. So you can synchronize those to cloud, and then when users try to log in, Azure AD is checking those credentials against Azure AD. But this doesn't support single sign-on, so that's the bad part. And the third one is password authentication, or PTA, where you install an agent on your on-prem environment, and that connects to Azure AD. And then when users are trying to log in, those credentials are sent to that agent. Agent tries to log in as that user, and then returns the result to cloud. And in this scenario, you don't need to synchronize passwords, so they are not in Azure AD. But this doesn't support single sign-on either. But there is a thing called seamless single sign-on, which can be used with password synchronization PTA, and then you will get also the single sign-on, which means that when you are logged into domain to a computer, you are also automatically logged to Azure AD. And a couple of words about security. So this is the cloud, and it's secure. So, and it's easy for users to use. So if you want to access services, you just need to provide a proof of identity, and you can access those services. And for bad guys, this is a bad thing, because they need to prove their identities. There are no firewalls or anything that they could hack, like in the back old good days. So actually, the only thing that the bad guy can compromise that cloud is to either use phishing or brute forcing. And at least the brute forcing is quite hard nowadays, which is good. So that's easy. But then let's talk about the hybrid security. So if you want to make it easier for your users to use same credentials in on-prem and cloud, you need to connect your on-prem to cloud, right? And it's also easier to manage for admins, because you don't need to manage 2 sets of credentials. So you can do it in on-prem. And guess what? This is much easier for bad guys, because they have a lot of ways to compromise your on-prem servers. And when they are able to do that, they can compromise your identity. And with that identity, you can compromise everything you have in cloud. So that's why we need to keep those safe. So now let's walk through each of these threats and mitigations that are resulting if you are using those on-prem, hybrid identities. So here is directory synchronization that is the core of hybrid identity. So you need to have this anyways, so that you can keep your on-prem and cloud in sync. And this is usually done using Azure AD Connect, which is a component. It's a free provided by Microsoft to do the synchronization. And that's what it does. Synchronizes things from on-prem to Azure AD. And a couple of technical details about that. So what is actually synchronized? So for instance, if you are a user, Azure AD contains a couple of attributes in Azure AD for that user object, which are important. And these are those three. The cloud anchor means that what's the user's ID in Azure AD. The source anchor means what is the user's ID in your on-prem AD. And SID is, well, the on-prem AD security identifier, or SID. So those three things are important to remember and understand. Okay. Now, if you want to attack this, the target would be the server that has Azure AD Connect. So that would be the bad guy's target. And why they want to target that is that the service, Azure AD Connect service, has a very high permission to both on-prem AD and Azure AD. And especially if you are using password hash synchronization, that service account can do DC sync. So it can replicate your domain, means that it can also get all your password hashes. So that's very kind of a nice target. And a couple of statistics before I'm going to show you the first demo. So of those 500 Fortune organizations who are using Azure AD, about 95 is using Azure AD Connect or synchronizing using Azure AD Connect. I don't know what the rest are doing. And from universities, it's roughly half. Okay, but now the demo, first demo. So I'm just going to show you that how easy it is for bad guys to dump the credentials. So let's see how this works. Okay. So here we are in a domain controller where I have installed the Azure AD Connect. You shouldn't do that. It should be a separate computer, but it's easier for me to demo. And I've already imported the AAD intelligence module. And now I'm just going to dump the credentials. So I'm going to save them in a variable. So one command and voila. And I'm going to show those to you, but only the on-prem. I won't show you the cloud password because you're going to hack my tenant then. Okay, so here we can see the user account that Azure AD Connect is using, msol underscore and something. And then the password is quite long. Okay, so it's not easy. So if someone can compromise your Azure AD Connect server, a couple of seconds and you have the credentials. And with these, you can do pretty much whatever you want to. So the hardening stuff, what should we do then to make this safer? So actually, this applies to every component that is somehow involved with hybrid identity. So you need to treat them as tier zero servers, which means that you need to protect them as well as you protect your domain controllers. So that's the first thing. And the second one is involved actually to that. And one thing that you can do to keep your, or mitigate the threat that when those credentials are compromised, they can be used also to create users to cloud. They can be used to edit users' details, used to delete users, and so on. So if you don't want to that, then you should limit the synchronization only from certain IP addresses, which means that you need one dedicated IP address, public IP address, you allow synchronization only from that IP address to Azure AD. So that way, if those credentials are compromised, you don't need to be afraid that those are used to create users and delete users and so on. Okay, then the next one, password authentication. So here, as I told you, there's an agent that is connected to your domain that is talking to connected to on-prem AD. And then that agent connects to Azure AD via service bus. This is an oversimplified description, but that's how it goes. And then, as I told you, when users type in username and password, they are sent to agent, and agent tries to log in to that domain and then returns the results. And attackers want to attack this computer that is running the PTA agent. And what is happening, what the attackers can do? Well, I'm going to demonstrate to you how I do it with AAD internals. But technically, it goes that you are inserting your own DLL to the running service, and it is replacing the logon user function that the system is using. And when you implement your own function, you can, for instance, accept all the passwords or deny all the passwords. It's up to you. So when bad guys compromise the computer, they can start to harvest credentials and also do backdoor by accepting all the passwords. So I'm going to demonstrate now that. And now I'm going to need your help. So I made a website. I'm going to show it to you, but just keep here for a couple of seconds so that you can either browse there by yourselves or use the QR code. And let me see, where's my... Here's the demo, and a couple of words about this. So I have three demos, 1, 2, and 3. And I have configured here three different domains, as you can see. We have Adaton, we have Contoso, and Woodgrow. And each of these have a little bit different configurations. And the first user of each domain has MFA enabled, and every second doesn't. Now, just don't type in there anything, because I don't want those accounts to get locked. I'm showing you that I'm typing here password and click login. And now what happens is that the backend is trying to get an access token, which we can see here. And well, it says now that you didn't get one because the credentials are not correct. So we won't be able to log in. But now let's go to our demo. And we are again in the same computer that is running that PTA agent. And now I'm going to run a script that installs the PTA's PI, which then starts to dump those passwords we are typing and also accept everything. Do you want to install? Yes. And now we should see. And now you are welcome to type in any password you want to. We can see it here, so don't type anything. Like, yeah, but it might be for MFA. So I should also get error for, because there's MFA requirement. But yeah, here we can say passwords. But no summer 2022, I'm disappointed. Yeah, so it's that easy, if that component compromised, that you can accept any password and you can harvest those credentials. And even though they would be MFA, you would still have those credentials. You can't log in as that user, but you have the credentials. Okay. So I'll just gonna stop this. And leave it there. Okay. Yes, so how do we harden this? Again, treat it as a tier zero server. Limit the number of on-prem admins, of course, that are able to log into that computer. That's also part of that tier zero stuff. But also you should limit the global admin users in your Azure AD, because if you are a global admin, you can register your own PTA agent, install it in your computer that you are controlling, and then you can do the same stuff, but in your home. So also limit number of those. And of course, use multi-factor authentication. Because even though now you are able to harvest those credentials, you are not able to log in. So that kind of mitigates that, but it doesn't remove the fact that you can still have those credentials. Okay. Let's move on to seamless single sign-on. And the technical name is desktop single sign-on. And in cloud here, Azure AD, we have a kind of a table of domains we have, and whether they are using seamless single sign-on or not. And then we have a password here. And this is based on Kerberos. Everybody knows Kerberos, right? So that's the basic authentication method you are using in Windows domains. And how it works is that there's a computer account here in On-Prem AD that is called Azure AD SSO ACC, and it has a certain password, right? So now when you configure this, seamless single sign-on, a computer account is created in your On-Prem AD, and also a service principal name is attached to that. And then that information is sent to Azure AD. So it sends the computer name, so computer account name, and then the password in plain text is sent to Azure AD, actually. Because that's how the Kerberos works. That you need to have the password, need to know the password so that you are able to verify those Kerberos tickets that are used. So the password of this computer account is stored in Azure AD also. And the ticket, Kerberos ticket, that is created by your on-prem AD and given to the browser, and then browser goes to Azure AD. It contains a lot of information, but here's only two. And what is important is the SID. So user SID has to be correct in that ticket, and that's it. So UPN can be anything. Azure AD doesn't care about that at all. So only the SID matters. So as long as you are giving Azure AD a ticket that is encrypted with the correct password, and you have the correct SID of any existing user in that tenant, you are allowed to log in. And this is not, the security boundary here is not the domain. So here are domains, here, as you can see. And you would imagine that only people from contoso.com can be logged in using this, because that's how it's configured. But no, as long as the seed is correct, user is able to log in, regardless of the domain. Because Azure AD doesn't care about that. So that's how this is built. Which means that even though you have one domain here and you are able to compromise that computer account, and get its password or password hash, you are able to log in as any user in that tenant, Azure AD tenant. And this is not very commonly known. So how many is using this seamless single sign-on? Okay. From Fortune 500 organizations. So any estimates? Half? You said third? Fourth, okay. Yeah. Well, this is a method that Microsoft is actually saying that please use this. But actually only like third is using And from universities, half of that. Okay, so we will use the same demo site, so you can try it yourself. There's nothing to be monitored this time, but you can try it out. So I'm going to show you how you can, how easily, now that we got those credentials from that Azure AD Connect server, that I'm showing you how easy it is now to steal the password hash of that account that is used to create those Kerberos tickets. So I'm back here. And I already stored those credentials to a variable here. Just gonna show them to you. We have the password here, a long one, and then the username here. And then I'm just gonna get that password hash. So this is actually on the background, it's using DC sync to get the password hash. So get AD int desktop SSO account password. Okay. Need to provide the server and then the credentials. And there is, that's just as hexadecimal, like this. Okay, now you just need to have this, and you need to know the seat of the user, and you can log in. Now the password is quite complex, and I didn't want for you to be copying that to use the demo. So let's do it a different way. So I'm just gonna reset the password to the Azure AD, and we can type it in here. So get AD int, As we can see, there's a domain that has this enabled. Domain, whatever, password. Anyone has a pet? Okay, so what's the name of your pet?
Not my password.
Sorry?
It's not my password. Yeah, you take choice, Bo, Daisy, or Molly. Or we have a new sheep as a
Daisy.
Tuesday, that's Hans Gruber.
So, yeah, so Daisy with a capital D. Okay, so now it's resetting that. And then when we go here, so we can see that the seat is changing when you select another user. And now you just type in here the password. You are able to get the access token for that user. And if we get the one that has MFA, it says no way, because you need to do MFA. And if we use some other password, as we can see, we are not able to get anything, just get an error. So you can do that by yourself if you want to, using the Daisy as a password.
So if you have multiple pets, can we do password rotation?
That's a good one. Yeah. Okay. Moving forward. So how to harden this? Again, treat this as a, well, because this is just a password on domain controller, you already need to, you know, treat that as a tier zero. But you should limit the number of on-prem admins that has access to do the DC sync. So just make sure that you limit those. And again, use multi-factor authentication. So if you are compromised and someone is creating those Kerberos tickets offline, if you are using multi-factor authentication, they are not able to log in. And then to the last one, identification. So same way then with a single sign-on, there's a table in Azure AD that has those domains, but also that are they managed or federated. There's a party going on there. And managed means that Azure AD is taking care of the authentication process. Federated means that it doesn't. So basically, when user is logging in and has already realized that, okay, this is actually a federated domain, it is redirecting you to your on-prem ADFS server. Then you authenticate, and you will get back a SAML token, or Security Asset Markup Language token. And with that token, you go back to Azure AD, and then Azure AD checks that does the signature match the public key of that identity provider's token signing certificate. And the SAML contains, again, a lot of information, whatever you want to put there, but what is important is the immutable ID, which was user's ID in on-prem AD, right? And here the target is that certificate, because if you have that, you can perform so-called golden SAML attacks. So you have the certificate, you have the user's identifier, and one extra information is called issuer URI. So you can get it from this server here. So if you have those three things, you can be anyone at that tenant. And here also, the security boundary is not the domain, but the whole tenant. So you can log in as any user you want to, as long as you know these three things. So how many is using federation? So first of all, from Fortune 500 organization, almost all have custom domains, which means that they are probably using email, and those 2% probably are not. And 68% of those organizations have at least one federated domain, which means that they are using this kind of seamless single sign-on. Now, if you combine that with the roughly 30% of seamless single sign-on, put them together, we can say that every organization is actually using some sort of single sign-on, which is good for attackers and, of course, good for users. And it was interesting that there's an average number of domains, and it was 66 on average, yeah. And there was one organization that had 2,030 domains. I don't know why, but they had. And those who had domains, on average 16 was federated. But actually, the number doesn't matter. You only need one federated domain, and you are able to penetrate to whole Azure AD. And from universities, federation only like 1/3, so quite low number. Why? I don't know. Okay, so next demo. So I'm now in the same computer. We have a folder called demo where there's nothing there. And I'm just gonna dump the ADFS certificate. So there are multiple ways to do that, but easiest way is to be able to log in as that computer that has ADFS installed as local admin. So you don't need to be domain admin, just local admin will do. And that's just so easy. One command, 2 seconds, and you're good to go. And here we have the certificates. So token signing certificate, PFX file without password. You get that, and you can be anyone. But there's one thing here that, well, I will show it to you. Okay. So now again, the certificate is quite hard for you to type in. So I'm gonna do another thing for you. So I'm gonna reset the issuer URI in the cloud. So the demo already has this certificate, and they are those immutable IDs. So the only thing that you just need to type in is that issuer URI. So I'm gonna list those domains now. As we can see, there's only one that is federated, the Adatom one. And we need to provide the domain name, anatem.aad security. Dot something. And what was the other pet? You had Daisy and what? So focused. Does anyone else have pets? So what was the other pet?
Daisy's actually watching everyone knows right now. So I'm watching the Star Wars. Luna.
Ah.
Molly.
Molly?
Okay,
so as we can see, this can be any string, so it doesn't have to be URI, so no HTTP or anything, just any text. And now when we go back here, the third demo, we can select anyone here, even those who have MFA. And just type in here Molly, and you'd be good to go. Oh. And that actually might take a couple of minutes to work. Oh, is it? Okay. Yeah. So there's a feature in identity federation that if you are creating that SAML token, you can put there a claim that says that I already did MFA. Don't do that anymore. Quite nice, right? So you can bypass MFA, at least now. Hopefully that will get fixed at some point. All righty, so. Sorry? No, I'm with pets now. Okay, so how to harden this? Again, tier zero server, and then there's one funny part, so close port 80. Why? Because when you are installing ADFS, you have to have at least two of them, and the default configuration is that when you install ADFS, you are using Windows internal databases or SQL Express databases, and the things are stored there. And now, the first server you install is the primary one, and then you install one or more secondary ones. And for these secondary servers, they need to get configuration somehow. So they are making a HTTP request to that primary server and get it that way. So which means that if you are able to compromise the password or password hash of that service account, you can remotely get that configuration anywhere. And why is that important is that the certificate is stored in that configuration database. So if you can get that, you can get the certificate remotely. Because the first thing that you should do when you realize that you're compromised, or ADFS service compromised, you need to recycle those certificates. But not a bad guy can get that again, a new one. So that's why you need to close the port 80 also. And then, of course, limit the number of global admins because they can register their own domains and put any certificate they want to. So that's why you also need to limit the number of those. Okay, call to action. So what you should do? Well, today or next week, maybe not this week anymore, check the OSINT of your organization. So one command and you can see, do you have any domains there? How many domains you have? Are they federated or not? Because you might have like tested federation 5 years ago and you left there one domain that's federated and someone has that certificate, they can log in as anyone they want to, okay? And then next month, after you have checked what kind of environment you have, what kind of authentication method you are using, you should assess, are they okay? Is the current setup okay? Should I use something else, like federation I'm using now? Should I do something else? And then after that, make a plan, and after that, implement that plan. So to sum up, I think we are on schedule quite right. So as I told you in the beginning, to protect your cloud, you need to protect your on-prem environment, right? That's it. So that's easy to remember. And also, remember that this also is the easiest way to get recon information for hackers or bad guys. So you should check that every now and then, because they are doing that anyways. And that's pretty much it. So if you want to follow these kind of things I'm presenting now on Twitter, please follow me. And you can DM me if there's something you want to ask, for instance. And by the way, remember, and give me feedback after the session, because otherwise they might let me here next year too. Okay, and with that, time for questions.
I have two. Number one, good presentation, by the way. Number one, you'd earlier said to, I think it was the AD Connect service, only allow it to talk to one IP.
Yep.
Which one, the main controller?
So in Azure AD, you have a thing called conditional access, okay? So in Azure AD, you can configure that this user can log in only from certain IP address. And that would be the...
Oh, like a paw.
Yeah.
Okay, I get you now, okay.
Yeah. So,
okay, and the second question, does Cloud Sync change any of this security-wise?
That's a good question. Well, yeah, but not necessarily in a good way. Okay. Well, not when the mic is open, let's put it this way. But I can talk to you. Yeah. Okay.
Hi. If you use external IDP, so Okta, whatever, you know, there's a bunch of them, does that change the game, or are you still vulnerable in the same or similar way? Because you still usually use, Azure AD Connect, but you don't like sync the same stuff, and you usually it's still a federated domain. So are you vulnerable to the same issues?
Yeah. Well, if you are using any identity provider for identity federation, there's a danger that when the token signing certificate is compromised, but I don't know. I think that's not that easy with Okta, because as far as I understand, that's a SaaS service, so there's nothing installed in your on-prem environment. So that way, it would be like more safe, I would say, because there's no risk for compromising that certificate in your own environment. But it's still open for, like, if you are able to compromise Azure AD Connect, you can still edit users there, you can create users and so on, even though the actual authentication is otherwise.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay. If not, thank you.